Good morning to my morning class. Good afternoon and good evening to my evening class in contemporary world. We are so sorry for the inconvenience that we are having right now because of this pandemic. Anyway, nothing can eventually prevent us from learning. Remember that learning, education is a tool for us to have a good life, a better life. Just don't mind about the pandemic. We are already in the so-called new normal. The contemporary world, meaning to say the present world, the modern times, encompasses everything. It encompasses all the subjects. Supposedly before, 2 years ago, we don't have contemporary world. After that, because of the K-12 program, we have this new subject, contemporary world, which encompasses all the social sciences subject mostly. So the economics is already here, the social sciences, the introduction to political science, logic, and everything. Why? What do you think is the reason? Because your present generation is, I guess, as because of internet, you are more advanced and more learned enough to comprehend the real world. Now, contemporary world means globalization. Globalization comes from the word globe. How are we going to interact with each other? Remember the saying, no man is an island. No man can exist alone. A government cannot exist alone. Although a government is a sovereign state, it is an independent state, it needs the aid of other countries. Just imagine, for example, what happens in Tacloban during the Yolanda period. Without globalization, without the aid of these foreign countries, WHO, United Nations, we cannot rise up as easy as that. Okay? Now, there are three important aspects of globalization. We have the internationalization means the products are being exported and imported from other countries. So right now we have the export and import products. Might be I'm wearing this one, this is imported, but this is okay, but still it's part of globalization, it's part of internationalization. You wanted something from other countries because you look good with that and you feel good with that, wearing Guess, Levi's, you wear Abercrombie, Chanel. So these are more on mentality also. Another form of contemporary world is the liberalization. We become more liberalized because we already know and being influenced by foreign world. Example, although we don't have gay same-sex marriage in the Philippines, we already accepted their existence, the LGBT group, and we no longer bully them because they are widely accepted. But in foreign countries, they are very much open to global, there is the same-sex marriage. But in the Philippines, since we are more on religious aspect, a lot of population are Christians, we still do not adhere to that. And in fact, the civil code is not yet amended. Marriage is only between men and women. And the purpose for marriage is procreation. Remember that. How can two persons with the same sex procreate? But it can, you know? If you have heard the news, I think that was 5 years ago, this woman is already a trans man. You know what is a trans man? The boobs have already been removed, but I think the ovary was not yet been removed. So she has a partner, and the partner is a girl, and she is a lesbian. Now what happens then is she was the one who made the injection to be pregnant. So she really looks masculine, but she gets pregnant indeed. She gave birth to twins, okay? So, pwede na ngayon, ganun ka-advanced, no? Even if you don't have sex with other individual, you can be pregnant because of the advance of technology. And that is also globalization. Last aspect of globalization is westernization. why do we love to use iPhone? Because it's more on Western culture. You feel also Westernized because you're using their gadgets. Why do you want to go to mall and buy these products which are more also Westernized? That is mental. That is mental already, mentality. Now, let us, before we proceed with the present world, with the globalized world, with globalization, let us first go back to our history. Remember our history, we were under the Spanish period for 333 years. There are no Filipino citizens on the time, remember. The term for Filipinos are idiots. There are no rights for the Filipinos right now on the time. Because the Philippines on the time is not a state. There are four essential elements of a state. We have people, government, sovereignty, and territory. We do not have people on the time because the people here were not deemed as Filipino citizens. They are merely idiots, as called by the Spaniards. The next is government. We do not have government on the time because we are governed and we are under the colony of Spain. Another is territory. Do we own our territory on the time? We do not. It is the Spanish regime that owns our territory. And lastly, sovereignty. What is sovereignty? Sovereignty, meaning to say freedom from foreign control. This is the reason why our president is not scared of any trial from outside countries because of even social injustices. Because we are a sovereign state, independent state. We can make our own laws. But remember, no man is an island. In making our laws, we cannot just create it without, it should be in consonance with other countries. Because we also depend on them with the product, with the financial aspect. You cannot control the imported products. You cannot say, we do not allow imported products in the country. No, because that is globalization. That is the exchange of goods and commodities. If we do not do that, our product also will not be allowed to be exported in other countries. Okay? Now, for the meantime, I will let you view a short film with regard to the history of the Philippine setting. Okay.
In the year 1841, the Union Jack was raised proudly over a barren little rock off the coast of Guangzhou. To many Chinese, this moment embodied their greatest shame. Their celestial kingdom had been cursed by a little poppy flower, whose ambrosial resin spread rot and decay throughout every level of their society. China was helpless to stop the Westerners from flooding their nation with this opium and claiming Chinese land for their own. As dawn rose over the British Crown colony of Hong Kong, one man stood responsible for all this. He was William Jardine, one of the biggest drug lords of all time and the opium king of China. We live in the information age, which means that the protection of our personal data and information is of the utmost importance. The sponsor of this video, Dashlane, is the best protection you can have in this new world. Dashlane is a cross-platform premium password manager and digital wallet application, and its mobile and desktop app gives you a shortcut for everything you do online. It works on every device and OS, allowing the user to fill forms fast with one-click logins and autofill for personal info and payment details. If there's any attempt to hack your account, Dashlane responds with personalized security alerts. Unlike other solutions, Dashlane never accesses your personal data, won't trick you into subscribing, never sees your data, and is always ad-free. So, what are you waiting for? Try it on your first device by heading to dashlane.com/kings and get 25% off premium with the code KINGS. In the late 18th century, China, ruled by the Imperial Qing Dynasty, was the wealthiest nation on earth, controlling 65% of global GDP, and its luxury products were considered second to none. For as long as Europeans had known about the Celestial Kingdom, they had craved its treasures, namely porcelain, silk, and most of all, tea. However, China had been closed off since the 15th century, allowing only incredibly limited interactions with the outside world. In 1757, the Qianlong Emperor decreed that any Westerners seeking trade with China had to do it at the southern port of Canton, isolating the potentially troublesome foreigners to one area. Furthermore, a conglomerate of wealthy Chinese merchant houses, collectively known as the Kohong, was given a government monopoly over foreign trade, allowing them to tax, tariff, and regulate European traders. Out of all the colonial powers, it was the British whose desire for Chinese products was the greatest. Their national megacorporation, the Honorable East India Company, had founded a factory in Canton in 1771, but business was far from harmonious. By 1800, the company was importing more than 20 million pounds of dried tea leaf per year. Before long, some 10% of the average British household income was being spent on imported tea alone. Britain had no real products that China was interested in, and thus had to sink piles upon piles of silver to get Chinese goods. The empire's coffers were being drained dry by Chinese trade. It is here that we must begin the story of our main character. William Jardine was born in 1784 on a small farm near Lochmaben, Scotland, under the shadow of the old castle of Robert the Bruce. His family was poor and struggled, but the boy was clever, so in the year 1800, his family saved up enough money to send him to the prestigious University of Edinburgh, where he would study to become a surgeon. Upon graduation, Jardine was hired as an employee of the East India Company, enlisting as a surgeon's mate aboard the RCS Brunswick. Thus, this 18-year-old Scotsman set off for China for the first time. After a long journey, the Brunswick arrived at Whampoa, a town some 12 miles downriver of Canton. It was a whole new world, and Jardine was immersed in the bustle of clanging gongs, crackling fireworks, and the Chinese river peoples plying the water lanes in their sampans. Over the next decade, Jardine made many journeys to China aboard company vessels. He quickly found that life as a company man was perilous. In 1805, Jardine's ship was captured by a Napoleonic warship and wrecked off the coast of South Africa. He managed to find passage back to England. But in 1809, his new vessel narrowly evaded a fleet of Chinese pirates led by Chang Pao. Nevertheless, where there is danger, there is always opportunity. During the first year of Jardine's tenure as a surgeon, the East India Company had found a dubious way to erase their trade deficit. It was, of course, opium. The product that grew in the British territory of Bengal was the highest quality in the world and incredibly addictive. It was this addiction that would generate Chinese demand for the product. Opium was illegal in China, and the East India Company did not want to jeopardize their foothold in Canton by engaging openly in forbidden trade. So, instead of importing the drug into China themselves, they produced it en masse in their factories in Bengal and sold it to private Indian agencies, who then passed the product to unscrupulous smugglers who would sneak it into China and return with the profits. This was a big deal, as formerly, the East India Company had held a government-mandated monopoly on all British trade going to China. By allowing private traders to do business for them, they put their own fate in jeopardy. The temptation to strike out as a legally mandated drug trafficker was all too tempting to many company employees who were willing to sacrifice moral integrity to get rich quick. In 1817, he left the East India Company. Entering into a business partnership with some old acquaintances, he managed to purchase his first ship, the Sarah. In 1819, the Scotsman sailed for Bombay, where he was reunited with an old friend, Jamseji Jejeboy, an Indian merchant of Zoroastrian Parsi extraction. Jejeboy had been aboard the Brunswick with Jardine when it was boarded by the French back in 1805. Now he was the head of one of Bombay's largest opium agencies, and Jardine's main supplier of opium for many years to come. Jardine and his associates became one of the more well-known opium cliques in the East. With each successful smuggling run, more partners joined, bringing with them ships, men, and assets. But among all of them, only one, a fellow Scotsman, would truly be Jardine's equal. James Matheson was an aspiring businessman in the employ of a wealthy Portuguese merchant, to whom he was something of an adopted son. When the latter died, Matheson inherited his ships and joined Jardine's growing fleet of smugglers. Matheson was every bit as cunning, ambitious, and wholly amoral as his new partner, and soon the two Scotsmen became the most dynamic duo on the South China Sea. In 1832, they restructured their business and co-founded the company known as Jardine Matheson's & Co. A year later, the British Parliament finally revoked the East India Company's trade monopoly, allowing Jardine and Matheson to fill the power vacuum. Smuggling illegal drugs onto the coast of a highly isolationist nation was a dangerous affair, and required intelligence, skill, and a great deal of luck. For Jardine Matheson's, the process usually began in India, where the Scotsmen acquired massive amounts of opium from their Parsi suppliers. The product was transported back to China aboard clippers. These cutting-edge modern sailing ships were capable of outpacing even steam-powered vessels. The Chinese demand for opium meant that there were always native buyers, and prominent smuggling hubs soon developed in the ports of Whampoa, Macau, and Linton. To get around Chinese laws, British drug lords anchored large cargo ships offshore, which served as floating depots where they stored the opium. This allowed them to technically argue that they weren't selling opium on Chinese soil. Pretty much everyone saw this farce for what it was, but centuries of isolation meant that the Qing government had no real navy to speak of, and was powerless to deal with the superior firepower of the British clippers. Additionally, the drug trade had corrupted every level of Chinese society, and there were more than enough officials willing to turn a blind eye in exchange for bribes. Ironically, the Kohong, which was specifically tasked to contain European influence, had become the key accomplice in the drug trade. From the floating depots, Chinese smugglers would buy opium in bulk in exchange for bullion of silver, then store the drug in speedy crafts known as fast crabs and scrambling dragons, and sail them up the shallow riverways of China, disseminating the addictive product throughout the nation. Meanwhile, the British traders would take their silver and use it to purchase precious tea from the Kohong in Canton, which they then shipped back home. Jardine never questioned the ethics of his business. Before long, the illegal smuggling of him and his competitors had created a nationwide health epidemic. The productivity of Chinese society tanked, as everyone from the lowest of peasants to the emperor's own palace guards could be found wasting away in hidden drug dens. The addiction was so dire that poor villages that had no rice to feed their people still ran opium stores to feed their morbid addiction. Between 1834 to 1841, Jardine Matheson's fleet grew into 19 great clippers and hundreds of smaller lurcher boats, more than any other private trading company in China. The pair had become impossibly wealthy, but now they were at the top, the challenge was to stay there, and Jardine was careful to cultivate an aura of authority around himself so that none would challenge him. He operated his drug empire out of an office in Canton, known as the Creek Hung. In it there was only one chair, his own. Visitors were not allowed to sit in the presence of Jardine, stressing the importance of his time. One anecdote tells a story that once while Jardine was on a business trip at the gates of Canton, a local Chinese, contemptuous of the foreign devils, struck him hard over the head with a piece of timber. Jardine did not even flinch at the blow and continued on his way as if nothing had happened. For this incident, he was nicknamed by the locals as the Iron-Headed Old Rat. At this point, every other trader in Canton referred to Jardine as the Taipan, a Chinese term roughly translating to Supreme Leader or the Big Shot. By 1838, the number of Chinese addicts was estimated to be anywhere from 4 to 12 million, largely a legacy of his influence. It seemed as if there was no one in China capable of stopping the illegal drug empire. That is, until the arrival of Lin Zexu. Lin Zexu was a special imperial commissioner acting on behalf of the Daoguang Emperor, who had ordered him to put an end to China's opium crisis by any means necessary. An incredibly well-respected figure, he was known to his people as Blue Sky, who considered him as pure and incorruptible as the heavens. One of Lin's first tactics was to appeal directly to the top. In 1838, he wrote an imploring letter to Queen Victoria, appealing to her sense of morality by highlighting the damage her citizens had done to China. The commissioner hoped that his words would move the young monarch into putting a stop to the opium trade, but she never received the letter. Getting no response, Lin decided it was time to lay down an iron fist. Within only a few months, he had arrested 1,700 Chinese opium dealers and confiscated 70,000 opium pipes. Terrified of the imperial commissioner, the Hong merchants pleaded with the British traders in Canton to give up their product, but they refused to do so. Lin responded to this by effectively laying siege to the foreign quarter of Canton, surrounding it with troops and isolating it from the outside world. He went so far as to cut off their food and water supply, and have his men endlessly bang huge gongs so as to keep the merchants deprived of sleep. Present at this showdown was Matheson, who insisted that his fellow drug lords should refuse to capitulate, convinced that Lin was bluffing. Fortunately, a new arrival would calm the rising tensions. The British Chief Superintendent of Trade, Charles Elliot, regarded the opium trade with disdain, and wished to prevent all-out war from brewing over the drug. To that end, he confiscated all the opium in Canton from the British traders, while promising the merchants that they would be compensated for their loss. The opium was then turned over to Lin Zexu, who had it all destroyed in bonfires. For their compliance, the Honorable Mandarin supplied 250 cattle to the starving merchants. Elliot and Lin's negotiations came very close to preventing a crisis, but the former hadn't the authority to promise that the British government would compensate the traders for their now incinerated product, and back in England, Parliament refused to pony up, insisting instead that the Chinese government had to compensate the traders. After all, it had been them who torched the goods. Every opium runner in China had just lost incalculable amounts, and they weren't getting it back. They wanted compensation, and they wanted war. To accomplish this, they turned to the greatest among them, the Taipan, Jardine. Jardine was incensed at the destruction of his property. For several years he had entertained the idea of provoking a war between Britain and China. Now he considered it a necessity. In September of 1839, Jardine arrived in London, where he started lobbying with the Secretary of British Foreign Affairs, Henry John Temple, Viscount of Palmerston. The Scottish drug lord impressed upon Palmerston the necessity of war. He knew the coastlines of China better than any Briton, and in a missive known as the Jardine Paper, he laid out a detailed plan for victory. This included a detailed battle strategy, and how many men and ships would be required to carry it out. Jardine wished to force the Daoguang Emperor to make three concessions. Firstly, the financial value of all the opium Lin Zexu had burned would be compensated in full. Secondly, the Canton system and the Kohong would be abolished, and four additional Chinese ports, Fuzhou, Ningbo, Shanghai and Xiamen, would be open to British trade. Thirdly, and most importantly, an island off the coast of China had to be ceded to the British Crown, a permanent base where British companies could operate under British law, rather than suffer under stringent Chinese commissioners like Lin Zexu. Jardine had a few suggestions on where this new colony should be, but he had his heart set on one in particular, a barren little rock just off the Kowloon Peninsula in Guangzhou. Jardine, Matheson and co. had used the island to smuggle opium in the past, and the Taipan knew that it had a naturally protected harbour. It was the perfect trading hub. Known to the fishermen who lived there as the Fragrant Harbour, this island was, of course, Hong Kong. Soon, Lord Palmerston caved under Jardine's pressure, and the British Empire finally declared war on China. It was a quick and one-sided affair. Chinese spears, bows, and matchlock muskets were no match for the cutting-edge British firepower, while the Imperial Qing armies were losing manpower, with many of its soldiers frail from opium, the very drug that had led them into the war in the first place. Relying largely upon the war plans drawn out by Jardine, the British had all but won the First Opium War by 1841. The iron-headed old rat had come out on top, and all of his war goals were achieved. Meanwhile, Lin Zexu was scapegoated for China's loss. Considered responsible for the Celestial Kingdom's great humiliation, he was exiled to remote Xinjiang. For Jardine, Hong Kong was the ultimate prize, a culmination of his many years of hard labor. Once it had been officially ceded to Britain, he and Matheson quickly set to work turning the bleak rock into the great colonial entrepot of the East. It was not a smooth transition, as typhoons and fires sabotaged early construction, malaria ravaged its settlers, and seaborne piracy was rampant. Nevertheless, the Scottish partners pushed on, continuing to be major promoters of the struggling island. Matheson established their company's new head office on the island's east point in 1842, while warehouses, wharves, and houses were built to accommodate the firm's business operations and employees. Hong Kong quickly turned into a boom town, doubling in population from 7,000 to 15,000 within its first year. While it would be untrue to say that Jardine Matheson and Co. were the sole driving force behind Hong Kong's success, it is unlikely that the tiny colony would have become the booming city it is today without the investment of the Scottish drug lords. At some point in 1842, William Jardine became afflicted with cancer. He continued to run his trading empire through his sickness, but on February 27, 1843, the Great Taipan passed away at the age of 59. The Crown Colony of Hong Kong continued to flourish, especially as a center for a newly resurgent opium trade, which the Chinese were now doubly helpless to stop. Following Jardine's death, the business was helmed at first by James Matheson and later by their descendants. As the fragrant harbor evolved from a colonial frontier into one of the world's most bustling trade cities, the descendants of William Jardine were always there at the center of it all, each of them bearing the title of Taipan as their ancestor had. Today, Jardine Matheson Holdings Limited is Hong Kong's largest private employer, second only to the government. A worldwide corporation, it has subsidiaries in cars, insurance, real estate, hygiene products, and hotels, among others. From these lofty peaks, we must not forget the humble origins and troubled history of Jardine Matheson's, which ultimately is the story of a peasant boy in the Scottish lowlands whose endless ambition saw him slowly become one of the most infamous drug lords of all time, and in doing so, forever changing the face of the Chinese world.
In 5,000 years of recorded history, only a handful of days are marked by climactic events. One such day will soon begin for a 29-year-old officer and the men in his command.
Gentlemen, when we met at Wendover for the first time about 10 months ago, I told you at that time that I had great hopes that the mission that we were about to undertake could end the war. At the same time, I offered to release any man who felt that he could not work under the conditions of mystery and possible danger that might prevail. That offer still goes, because this bomb that you're going to use is not an ordinary bomb. It's not a 1,000-pounder. It's not a 10-ton blockbuster. This bomb has the strength of 20,000 tons of TNT.
August 6, 1945. The day a new era dawned at Hiroshima in the light of an atomic bomb. In the 10 seconds that shook the world. Providence made the raging sun to burn for endless time, and from this flaming orb spring man and life and all the world. So man has praised the sun, and long since time began to find the source that gives it life.
The equation E is equal mc square, in which energy is put equal to mass multiplied with the square of the velocity of light, showed that very small amount of mass may be converted into a very large amount of energy.
E equals mc squared, the words of Albert Einstein. And from this wellspring, science built the atomic age. But it took 40 years and all the genius of man. In 1905, Einstein produces his startling equation and gives new meaning to Madame Curie's discovery of radium. For New Zealand's Ernest Rutherford, radium unlocks the heart of the atom. Rutherford's protege, James Chadwick, explores the atom and finds the neutron. Madame Curie's daughter, Irene Juliette Curie, experiments with the neutron. And her success leads Italy's Enrico Fermi to the brink of the greatest discovery. Without realizing it, Fermi has split the atom, violating a commonly held law of physics that an atom of matter cannot be created or destroyed. Fermi has released the enormous energy foreseen in Einstein's equation, E equals mc squared. One of Fermi's aides will later say, "We simply weren't prepared to see it." But studying the work of Fermi and others, Otto Hahn and Fritz Strassmann suddenly realize the incredible truth and become the first men to prove that the atom has been split. The triumphant discovery occurs in Adolf Hitler's Nazi Germany. But ironically, the burning of books, the campaign to exterminate 11 million Jews, drives out the very men who might have given Hitler limitless power. Albert Einstein flees to the United States. He leads a vanguard of refugee scientists, virtually stripping German universities of their best minds. One teacher compares Einstein's migration to the possible transfer of Vatican City from Rome to the New World. The Pope of Physics has moved, he says, and the United States will now become the center of the natural sciences. December 10th, 1938. In Stockholm, Sweden's King Gustav arrives for the presentation of the Nobel Prizes. Enrico Fermi, Italy's foremost physicist, is honored for achievement in atomic research. For Fermi, the Nobel Award provides the means to escape the oppression of Mussolini's regime. He will use the prize money to take himself and his family from Sweden directly to the United States, to freedom. In a final gesture of disdain, he violates Mussolini's orders by bowing to King Gustav instead of delivering the fascist salute. Neither Fermi nor the distinguished audience in Concert Hall can know that at this instant, in Berlin, Otto Hahn and Fritz Strassmann realize that they have split the atom. January 1939. As Fermi arrives in New York to accept a teaching post at Columbia University, news of the discovery in Berlin reaches the college. Refugee scientists working at Columbia suddenly realize that splitting of the atom places Hitler one step from making an atom bomb. Fermi and four colleagues decide they must alert the United States government to the danger. Because he is a Nobel laureate, Fermi will be the spokesman. On March 17, 1939, Fermi meets in Washington with Navy representatives. In halting English, he tells his story of an incredible new weapon. But skeptical officers answer only, "Keep working. We'll be in touch with you." Desperately seeking a means to warn the government of the danger, Edward Teller, and a second associate of Enrico Fermi, Leo Szilard, carry their appeal to the only scientist with enough stature to make Washington take notice, Albert Einstein. The gentle genius refuses the request that he go in person to the president, but finally agrees to sign a letter prepared by Szilard. Theoretically, the letter says, a bomb can be constructed that will destroy an entire port. Dated August 2, 1939, it is addressed to F.D. Roosevelt, the White House. At the White House, however, emergency cabinet meetings occupy Roosevelt as war threatens to engulf all of Europe. In this crisis, Einstein's letter receives only passing attention and is filed with the note, we must do something about this. Spring 1940, Hitler's blitzkrieg strikes. Belgium provides Hitler with uranium, and in Denmark he captures physicist Niels Bohr. Norway's heavy water plant gives him another key to the atom bomb, and Paris rewards him with the finest atomic laboratory in Europe. By the fall of 1940, Hitler's Third Reich can produce history's most destructive weapon. In Washington, the clamor for a large-scale research program to develop atomic energy reaches the White House through scientists like James Conant and Carl Compton. Echoing the fears of their colleagues, they finally convince Roosevelt of the need for action. The all-out drive is launched. It is December the 6th, 1941. By the summer of 1942, control of the atom bomb project passes to the hands of the Army under the code name Manhattan Engineering District. Engineer Chief General Eugene Reibold gives command of the Manhattan Project to Brigadier General Leslie Groves, the man who built the Pentagon. The security lid is clamped on. The Manhattan Project is so secret that only a handful of people know it exists. Even carefully screened personnel are given only enough information to do their jobs. Newspaper men receive a list of words banned for the duration. To avoid arousing suspicion, the key phrases uranium fission and atomic energy are spotted among fictitious names like yttrium. Science editors cannot write about atomic physics. Even the comic strip Flash Gordon is censored. The word atom disappears from the vocabulary of America. American colleges are now raided for manpower. Students are snatched from the campus and drafted into the Manhattan Project. Nobel Prize winner Ernest Lawrence is thrust into the work, along with brilliant young men like J. Robert Oppenheimer. From Columbia University comes Dr. Harold Urey, Nobel laureate in chemistry. Still another Nobel winner, Dr. Arthur Compton, helps launch a vital experiment from a makeshift laboratory beneath Chicago University's Stagg Field. Here on December 2, 1942, scientists attempt to start a controlled chain reaction to prove the theory that a bomb is possible. But they also face a danger. If they lose control of the chain reaction, Stagg Field may blow up, and radiation could endanger the city of Chicago. Enrico Fermi ignites the first atomic fire. A neutron counter broadcasts activity inside the furnace as the first control rod is withdrawn. When the last one is out, theoretically, a chain reaction will begin. At 3 p.m., Fermi and his assistant gingerly approach the threshold of a new age. A coded message called to Washington heralds Fermi's success. The Italian navigator has landed in the New World. Now, across America, nerve centers are chosen for producing an atom bomb. Pasco, Washington. Here, a giant industrial complex will blossom. Wendover Field, Utah, will become a special Air Force training base. Somewhere in New Mexico, a test site must be chosen. But it is in a secluded valley near Clinton, Tennessee, that the first work begins. Here at Oak Ridge, the largest manufacturing plant ever conceived begins to rise. It must produce 100 pounds of uranium-235, till now a product available only in microscopic quantity. Date for delivery is less than 2 years away. In a nation strained by the demand for wartime armament, an unbelievable amount of manpower and material is diverted to Oak Ridge, but sometimes not enough. Short of copper wire, project officers request the only suitable replacement, silver, 10 tons of it. Says an amazed Treasury official, here we don't speak of silver in tons. Our unit of measurement is the troy ounce. Nevertheless, $300 million worth of silver is melted down for use as wire in the plant at Oak Ridge. The net of security surrounding Oak Ridge keeps most of its 82,000 workers from knowing precisely what they're producing. Whatever it is, says one man, they can probably buy it cheaper. To maintain secrecy, personnel hired to empty trash cans must be illiterate, so they cannot stumble on classified documents. One Tennessee native says, strange place. Everything goes in, nothing comes out. In Washington, the expenditure of almost $1 billion causes a stir among congressional leaders. The head of the Senate Military Affairs Committee is about to launch an investigation when Secretary of War Stimson privately tells him, I can't tell you what it is, Senator Truman, but it's the greatest project in the history of the world. Truman calls off the investigation. General Groves summons to Washington Dr. J. Robert Oppenheimer and tells him he will head the largest scientific effort to date, the final development of the bomb. Groves has been warned that Oppenheimer's youthful associations with communist sympathizers may make him a security risk. Irrespective of information you have, Groves will write, Oppenheimer is absolutely essential to the project. Together, they decide to choose as their laboratory site an area near Oppenheimer's ranch in New Mexico. Isolated in the foothills of the Rockies, a town will grow here, known to its residents as Los Alamos. But to the world, it is simply Post Office Box 1663. March 1943. Convoys truck in supplies over primitive roads. Days later, scientists and their families suddenly find themselves deposited in this strange new town. Here, they're told, you will stay for the duration. No leaves, no vacations, and no one may know where you are or what you're doing. In an address to his staff, General Groves says, your jobs won't be easy. At enormous expense, we have assembled the greatest collection of crackpots ever seen. The crackpots number among them 12 Nobel Prize winners, men like Fermi, Lawrence, a melting pot of genius, a think factory, where under Oppenheimer's leadership, they must find the answers to questions that have never before been asked. Men like Edward Teller once estimated that it would take 20 years to perfect a bomb. The time allotted the Manhattan Project is barely 2 years. Late in the summer of 1944, the nucleus of the squadron picked to drop the first atom bomb gathers at Wendover Field, Utah. Their commanding officer, 29-year-old Colonel Paul Tibbetts, is allowed to tell them only, we can shorten the war. Their orders are simple. keep your eyes open and your mouth shut. The 509th Composite Group starts a unique training program. Veteran bombardiers must learn a radical new procedure. They practice dropping a single bomb from 30,000 feet with unerring accuracy, and then get their planes away as fast as they can. In England, Allied intelligence officers, fearing that Germany may also be close to completing an atomic bomb, order one of the key manufacturing plants destroyed. In Norway, the Germans have the only major center for producing heavy water, a vital element in creating the bomb. After damaging commando raids limit production, British bombers are sent in to put the plant totally out of commission. Concentrating on the production of V-2 rockets, Adolf Hitler has long ago abandoned atomic energy projects. But Allied intelligence reports still predict that Hitler might be close to having an atom bomb, and the fear serves as a spur to American scientists. Hornada de Muerto Valley, literally, the Valley of the Acres of Death, near Alamogordo, New Mexico. Here, in 5 months, in July 1945, the first test is scheduled for an atom bomb. One of the first pieces of equipment to arrive is a massive steel safe, weighing 150 tons and named Jumbo. A naive plan calls for the atom bomb to be exploded inside this safe, so that in case of a misfire, a partial dud, the precious supply of plutonium won't be scattered over the desert, but saved to be used again. Jumbo is insurance for $1 billion worth of plutonium. The test site is made ready. Oak Ridge and Hanford are producing uranium and plutonium. But even now, an atomic bomb is still a bit of theory that may yet prove false. The death of Franklin Delano Roosevelt on April 12, 1945, thrusts a little-known former senator from Missouri, Harry Truman, into the office of the presidency. On this day, for the first time, he learns of the Manhattan Project and the awesome decision he will have to make in the months to come. At the Pentagon in Washington on May 31st, 1945, a vital meeting is held at the request of President Truman. The Interim Committee, a panel of 12, including scientists, businessmen, and military leaders, must advise the President on whether or not the United States should use the atomic bomb. Four choices are outlined to the Interim Committee by Secretary of War Stimson. One, forgo the bomb and invade Japan. Two, demonstrate the weapon on a deserted island. Three, warn the Japanese in advance of the target city. Four, drop the bomb. The first choice, the plans for the invasion of Japan, Operations Olympic and Coronet, are revealed to the committee. 5 million men are to be committed to the kind of fighting that has taken such a terrible toll of life in the South Pacific. Thank you. landings, it is estimated, will cost 1 million American lives and countless millions of Japanese. Number two, a demonstration for the Japanese on a deserted island proves impractical. Failure would mean an incalculable lift to Japanese morale. The third choice, prior warning, might cause the Japanese to move American prisoners of war into the target city to thwart the plan. The decision of the interim committee is rendered. Apparently, there is no alternative but to use the bomb without prior warning. Orders are sent to B-29 bases in the South Pacific, removing four cities from the bombing lists: Hiroshima, Kyoto, Kokura, and Niigata. They are prime targets for the first atom bomb to be left undamaged so that the full effect of the explosion may be realized by the Japanese. Mass raids on Japan continue, however, and in one day, 850 B-29s are sent to strike at the Japanese Empire. In one raid, 16 square miles of Tokyo are set ablaze. More than 100,000 killed. In Tokyo, Emperor Hirohito asks his cabinet to end the war. But the men who launched Japan on the road to conquest refuse now to surrender. They pray instead for miracles. Friday, July 13th, 1945. Under armed guard, the atom bomb is moved from Los Alamos to Hornada de Muerto Valley. Ground zero for the test is dominated by a 100-foot tower called the Gimmick. In a canvas tent at its base, scientists assemble the first atom bomb. Oppenheimer supervises the final preparations, aware that 3 years of intensive effort and $2 billion hang in the balance. The nightmare of failure haunts them all, and when they take up a pool to calculate the power of this bomb, scientists vie for the lowest possible figure. A short poem expresses their doubts. From this crude lab that spawned the dud, there next to Truman's axe uncurled, lo, the embattled savant stood, and fired the flop heard round the world. Press releases are prepared. If the bomb works, the public will be told that an ammunition dump accidentally exploded. Should the bomb go off with unexpected force, killing the key men at the test site, the world will learn only that a freak fire at Oppenheimer's ranch took the lives of America's top physicists. The army dispatches buses and trucks to the town of Carrizozo, 30 miles from the test site. to stand by in case the population of 1,500 must be evacuated. Airports within 100 miles are told without explanation that all air traffic is banned from the area. Says a busy switchboard operator, something big is sure gonna happen. On July 15th, all non-essential personnel are ordered out of the test area. 150 selected officers and civilian scientists will be allowed to witness the payoff to their work. Some are sent to an observation post called Campania Hill, 20 miles from Ground Zero. At the last moment, Jumbo, the huge steel safe, has been abandoned. Scientists suddenly realize that a successful explosion would hurl 150 tons of steel across the countryside like so much shrapnel. Instead, Jumbo is set up 2,000 yards from Ground Zero. The central control point is 5.5 miles from the tower. Lines connect it to reinforced observation posts in the inner perimeter. Everything is in place at 0-12 hours. On this day, President Truman arrives in Berlin for the Potsdam Conference, a meeting with Stalin and Churchill. Truman is aware that the test is proceeding on schedule in New Mexico. By chance, Stalin's late arrival will delay the start of the conference until tomorrow. By then, a successful test might mean that the United States will not need Stalin's help to end the war with Japan. The outcome of the negotiations at Potsdam may radically change in the next few hours. At Alamogordo, a flare lights the night sky, signal that the countdown has started. An automatic timing device now controls the test.
40, 39, 38, 37.
To the machine is entrusted the future of man.
34, 33, 32, 31, 30, 29, 28, 27, 26, 25, 24, 23, 22.
At 29 minutes and 50 seconds past 5 a.m. on July 16th, 1945, the last flare is fired. 0 minus 10 seconds.
9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, now.
By the genius of man, a new age is born. In the roar of thunder and the fire of the sun. In this instant, Robert Oppenheimer recalls a passage from a sacred book of the Hindus. I am become death, the shatterer of worlds. On the first day of the atomic age, a handful of men survey the fringes of the test site. For a brusque, demanding general and a gentle, determined scientist, this is a day of triumph. And at Los Alamos, a night of celebration. For Enrico Fermi and Edward Teller, a 6-year struggle has ended. For Ernest Lawrence and hundreds of others, a mood of jubilance tempered by a single question. What have we wrought? Truman receives news of the test at Potsdam. And now the final decision is his. Among top Army officers, opinion varies. General Eisenhower will tell Stimson, we shouldn't introduce into war something as horrible as this weapon. Truman's top aide, Admiral Leahy, still maintains that the weapon is nothing more than a professor's dream. At Potsdam, Truman fulfills a pledge made to Winston Churchill. 2 years before, President Roosevelt had agreed that Britain would be consulted before a final decision was made regarding an atomic bomb. Churchill tells Truman there is no question that the bomb must be used. In later years, he will write of this day, we seem suddenly to have become possessed of a merciful abridgment of the slaughter in the East. Stalin poses a problem for Truman and Churchill. Should they tell him of the new weapon? Both leaders decide that to show their good faith, they will inform their intransigent ally of the successful test. Truman chooses an informal moment to relate the story, but the Russian premier simply shrugs. 3 days ago, the news had been given to him by Russian spies. The time for decision has come. In Truman's own words, I did not like the weapon, but I had no qualms if in the long run millions of lives could be saved. On July 25th, the order is issued. Use of the bomb approved. To the Pentagon, to Los Alamos, to the island of Tinian goes the alert. Critical bomb parts start the trip to the airbase in the South Pacific, on the island of Tinian, where the 509th, the Atom Bomb Squadron, has already been stationed. By air, scientists who will make the final bomb assembly leave the United States. On this day, the cruiser Indianapolis arrives at Tinian carrying the casing for the bomb and part of the critical block of uranium needed to set off an atomic explosion.
Greetings, everybody. This is your number one enemy, your favorite playmate, Orphan Anne of Radio Tokyo. The little sunbeam whose throat we'd like to cut.
In her broadcast, Tokyo Rose taunts the 509th Squadron, saying, we know you're there, but why aren't you doing anything? Throughout the airbase at Tinian, the same question is being asked. Other units call the 509th Glory Boys. Writes one wit, into the air their secret rose. Where they're going, no one knows. But take it from one who knows the score. The 509th is winning the war. More than 1,000 highly trained specialists grin, bear it, and sweat out each day wondering, when? July 28, 1945. In Tokyo, an emergency meeting of the Japanese cabinet is summoned to consider Allied demands for immediate unconditional surrender. Their decision? Mokusatsu. Answer only with silence. August 1st. General Curtis LeMay outlines plans for the first atomic bomb raid. Because Hiroshima has no reported prisoner of war camps, it becomes primary target. The date for the raid is set, August the 6th. On August 2nd, President Truman begins his trip home, stopping briefly in England to meet with King George. During an informal talk with the President and Admiral Leahy, the King mentions the atomic bomb. Says Leahy, it won't work. To the Admiral's surprise, the King answers, would you like to make a bet on that? On the island of Tinian, it is Sunday, August the 5th. And a single B-29 is brought under armed guard to an isolated corner of Northfield. Sleek, stripped of all but essential equipment, a million-dollar plane is is assigned to carry a $2 billion cargo. Colonel Tibbetts, in honor of his mother, has named his plane the Enola Gay. Prime concern on this day is the possibility that the Enola Gay may crash on takeoff and blow up all of Tinian. It is decided that the dangerous job of arming the bomb will be done after the plane is up. Even now, no one on Tinian is allowed to see the bomb. Late in the afternoon, the squadron is given a final briefing. Weather planes, they learn, will precede them to the target cities. If the primary city, Hiroshima, is overcast, they will take the one that is open, either Kokura or Nagasaki. The takeoff will be dangerous because the weight of their payload is over 10,000 pounds. And now they learn, too, its full potential.
It's not a 1,000-pounder. It's not a 10-ton blockbuster. This bomb has the strength of 20,000 tons of TNT. A bomb similar to one that we're going to use was exploded in the desert in New Mexico.
Steaming toward home at this moment, Harry Truman knows the decision is irrevocable. The wheels have gone full turn. In the Pentagon, General Groves and his staff remain overnight, beginning the long wait. 2,000 miles away, in Los Alamos, Robert Oppenheimer also waits. (Phone rings) 2:15 a.m., August 6th. For 12 men, Colonel Tibbetts, the crew of the Enola Gay, and the Navy captain who will arm the bomb, William Parsons, the last moments pass with bewildering speed. Then it's time to go, with the nagging fear that the Enola Gay might not make it off the ground. (Phone rings) 5 a.m. Alone, the Enola Gay begins her flight to one of three cities on the islands of Japan. In Moscow, on this day, Stalin returns to the Kremlin as the last light of the northern sun begins to fade. In London, it is 8:45 p.m. American GIs, veterans of combat in Europe, wait out orders to ship home or on to the South Pacific. 3:45 p.m. at Coney Island, New York. More than a million people jam the beach, each concerned with his own special problems. 4:52 a.m., August 6th. The Enola Gay reaches her first checkpoint. Below is the snout of Mount Suribachi, the pork chop shape of Iwo Jima. Two escort planes from the 509th rendezvous with the Enola Gay, the great artiste and number 91. On schedule, the three planes wheel toward Japan. 8:52 a.m. in Clinton, Tennessee, where the first church services of the day are over, and a Sunday school picnic is about to begin. Early bird shoppers in Los Angeles seek out ration stamp bargains. A division of Marines saddle up in San Diego, earmarked for the invasion of Japan. Aboard the Enola Gay, it is 7:25 a.m., and a message comes from an advance weather plane. Advice, bomb primary, says Colonel Tibbetts. It's Hiroshima. In the Pacific dawn of August 6th, a task force searches for survivors of the cruiser Indianapolis, torpedoed after leaving Tinian. On this Monday in the jungles of Luzon, the business of war goes on as usual. The all clear sounds in Hiroshima. An observation plane has made a pass at the city, but dropped no bombs. The Enola Gay arrives at 8:11 a.m. on time, on target. Take the bomb 43 seconds to reach Hiroshima. The Enola Gay strains to escape the fury she has unleashed. At zero minus 15 seconds, a warning tone sounds in the plane. In 10 seconds, the world will shake. Generations yet unborn, for centuries ahead, for all time to come, Hiroshima stands as mute witness to the tragedy of war in the age of the atom. Searing heat and cataclysmic force that destroyed a city, that shook the world, now bring peace. Aboard the battleship Missouri in Tokyo Harbor, on September 2nd, 1945, General Douglas MacArthur opens the ceremony that marks the surrender of the Japanese Empire.
It is my earnest hope, and indeed the hope of all mankind, that from this solemn occasion, a better world shall emerge out of the blood and carnage of the past. A world founded upon faith and understanding.
They shall beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. Hiroshima. Here a new age began, and here a new city has grown. Proof that ultimately, the will, the mind, the spirit of man triumphs. To future generations belongs the promise born in this city. And in the laboratories at Oak Ridge, Hanford, and Los Alamos, that promise is being fulfilled. A young breed of scientists continues to develop the great potential stored within the atom. The Manhattan Project has given way to peacetime projects, to studies of atomic surgery that will one day revolutionize medicine, to the design of nuclear power plants to supply electricity for home and industry, to Project Rover, research on nuclear rockets to propel man to the infinity of space, and Operation Plowshare to carve canals and tunnel through mountains. Here, the atom shapes tomorrow's world.
We will have an accelerator beam in 5 seconds. 4, 3, 2, 1. We now have an accelerator beam.
On a summer day in 1945, the stillness was shattered in a remote New Mexico desert. A million years of civilization had produced the birth of the atomic age. A force for good or evil? The choice belongs to man.
The Great War seriously undermined the global perception of superior Western values. It plunged the world into new barbarism. An entire generation was brutalized and embittered. The German people were subject to a savage punishment for the mistakes of their leaders. The Wall Street crash of 1929 caused a seismic shift in the international order. Millions became jobless, and millions more were plunged into poverty. There was a global sentiment for change. Liberal democracy was under threat, like never before. Economic depression laid fertile ground for the rise of communism. Terrified at such a prospect, the anti-communist right wing swung towards militarism and fascism with the promise of a strong nation. Democracy in Italy, Japan, and Germany turned sour under the heat of economic depression. In Italy, Mussolini became more radical after the Depression. In Japan, imperialism was seen as the only solution for Japan's problems. In Germany, Hitler seized power and began to build what was to become the world's most efficient and brutal war machine. The defenders of the current civilization were few indeed. Amongst them were Britain and France. Both nations possessed empires that totaled a third of the world's surface. Neither state, however, had enough money or resources to defend such a vast empire. The fashionable view was that empires were a source of political strength and economic nourishment. This led the three revisionist nations to conclude that their only chance of salvation was in attaining an empire. In 1931, Japan annexed Manchuria with little repercussions and later waged war with China. In 1936, Italy supported the nationalists in Spain and invaded Abyssinia. And Germany capitalized on the fear and appeasement of Britain and France and began to remilitarize the Rhineland, annex Austria, the Sudetenland, and eventually the whole of Czechoslovakia. Hitler also signed a pact with Stalin to avoid the mistakes of his predecessors. But Poland was the red line. When war broke out in September 1939, there was widespread fear in the West that the march of Hitler's brutal armies signaled the end of Western civilization. The three revisionist powers vowed to establish a new global order. On the 27th of September 1940, the Axis powers signed the Tripartite Pact that unified their global ambitions. By 1941, the Wehrmacht had conquered most of Europe in what had been an extraordinary display of military might. The French were crushed within 6 weeks, while the British retreated at Dunkirk. The Italians had gained dominance over the Mediterranean and North Africa, while Japan established its hegemony over Southeast Asia. Barbarism was taking the world hostage. Hitler now turned his attention eastwards, towards Russia. Lebensraum was a long-desired goal for Hitler, and now was the opportunity to achieve that goal. The rich steppe areas of Ukraine, the abundant oil of the Caucasus, and the iron and steel basin of southern Russia all provided the necessary economic nourishment for Hitler's empire. Only the Red Army stood between Hitler's goal of world domination. By late 1940, Hitler began to draw up plans to invade the Soviet Union. Stalin was advised numerous times by Soviet as well as British intelligence of a large buildup of German troops in the east. He dismissed these warnings as fear-mongering. On the 22nd of July, 1941, the biggest land invasion in history was conducted, Operation Barbarossa. Three million troops marched eastwards with the intent of seizing Moscow, Leningrad, and the industrial South. In the first few months of the war, the Wehrmacht were triumphant. It was the Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor on the 7th of December 1941 that tipped the balance of power, as it dragged the largest industrial power into the war, America.
I ask that the Congress declare that since the unprovoked and dastardly attack by Japan on Sunday, December 7th, 1941, a state of war has existed between the United States and the Japanese Empire.
By early 1942, the Axis were reaching the limits of their power as they began to face logistical problems, although this wasn't known by the Allies at the time. Hitler would often ignore the advice of his generals, and this would cost him dearly. The fear of global Axis enslavement mobilized the Allies to attain total victory at all costs.
We shall fight on the beaches, we shall fight on the landing grounds, we shall fight in the fields and in the streets, we shall fight in the hills, we shall never surrender.
By 1943, the Allies had managed to outproduce the Axis in every department – tanks, aircraft, trucks, ships, and so on – while also adapting to the conditions of mobilized warfare. 1942 to 1944 saw major turning points in all the theaters of war. In 1943, Sicily was captured. And by 1944, the Deuce was overthrown. Japan had lost the Battle of Midway and the Battle of Coral Sea. And on the Eastern Front, the Germans had lost the Battle of Stalingrad and the Battle of Kursk at the hands of the Soviet steamroller. They were now in full retreat. On the 6th of June, 1944, the Allies had launched the largest amphibious assault in history, Operation Overlord, better known as D-Day. A combined force of over 150,000 Allied forces stormed the shores of northern France. It was the final blow to Nazi ambitions. in 1945, the Soviet Union and the Western powers competed over capturing Berlin. On the 30th of April, 1945, the rapid advance of the Allied armies confirmed that Axis victory was impossible. Hitler had committed suicide. On the 8th of May, 1945, Italy and Germany were finally liberated.
General Eisenhower informs me that the forces of Germany have surrendered to the United Nations.
But the Japanese fought on. President Harry S. Truman decided to deploy the world's first superweapon, the nuclear bomb. On the 6th of August, 1945, Hiroshima was obliterated by a nuclear bomb. 150,000 civilians perished instantly. On the 9th of August, 1945, Nagasaki was also decimated by a nuclear bomb. 75,000 civilians perished. At the mercy of these destructive weapons, Japan surrendered on the 15th of August, 1945.
General Douglas MacArthur has been appointed the Supreme Allied Commander to receive the Japanese surrender.
Although many reports suggest that they were pursuing peace through neutral countries before the deployment of nuclear weapons, but it was simply ignored. On the 2nd of September, 1945, the most brutal conflict in human history that cost the lives of over 50 million people was finally over. It was a Pyrrhic victory for everyone involved, apart from the USA. For more content like this, please like the video, subscribe to Global Frontier, and donate if possible.
Okay, after watching the video and with my discussion a while ago, your activity for this week, which will be submitted on Friday, August, that will be September 4, and it should not exceed 12 noon, submitted on my Gmail account. If it would exit at 12 noon, I would no longer consider it submitted, okay? So you already lack one requirement from me. So the question for the activity is, what are the three forms of globalization? The three forms of globalization you discuss in three Kopenban, then you place a picture in each form. Remember the three forms of globalization? So one Kopenban, one picture, and below it, explain. Next Kopenban, another picture, then you explain below. And the last Kopenban, another picture half, then explain below. Just handwritten. Submit it to me through the Gmail account. Okay? Thank you and good luck. God bless.